Okay, so a little bit about myself. My name is Sarah. I work for Pankow Builders. We're a general contractor based in California, the Bay Area, and Southern California. Pasadena, for those of you who are from California. We have about 200 to 250 salaried employees between the two regions. And even within those two regions, we're spread out on anywhere from 10 to 15 active job sites happening around our region. So in addition to the 200 to 250 employees that we have, we also have field crews that we have on our job sites. So we can range up to 1,000 people that we're managing. And those people can come and go on a regular basis from our job sites. So it's a little bit about some of the interesting things that we come up against in trying to really build a lean culture, is the ability to train people, get them to buy in when they may just actually leave us in 6 months to go to another job. So maybe, am I too far away? Sure. Let me just to say next. All right. So in about 2014, our leadership group decided to come up with a strategic plan to build a lean culture, to see waste and eliminate waste and build value in everything that we do. And we kind of came up with this tagline that we wanted to flip the curve in the construction industry, and that lean was our way of doing that. So go ahead next. So a little bit about our lean timeline. Our lean journey started about 2004. We had one or two people in the company who were fundamental in joining and building the Lean Construction Institute. So for those of you who are in the construction industry, you may have heard of us. And so we kind of progressed. I'll do this in a nutshell. But we had the typical focus on tools in about 2008, where we were trying to roll out the tools to some of the companies, the lean tool, and it just didn't go anywhere. It fell flat on its face, right? We were focusing too much on the process. So in about, 2012, Paul came to one of the Northern California LCI chapters and gave us a presentation on two-second lean improvement. I saw him again in 2013 in Dallas, at our annual Congress for LCI. And in 2014, I was asked to do a presentation to the board on lean. So we have, like I said, we have the two different regions in the company. Our Northern California region was a little bit more exposed to lean because we had an owner there who was really driving it. That was my introduction to it in 2008, was through that owner. And our Southern California region had no clue what it was. You could ask them and they would tell you it was lead. For any of you who are familiar with LEED, that's sustainability. It has nothing to do with lean. So I was asked to come to the executive group and give a presentation on what lean was. And I thought it was the perfect opportunity to bring up Paul's two-second improvement videos and just teach them it can be something super simple. We don't need to make this complicated. We don't need to use a bunch of Japanese terms. This is really just about seeing waste in everything that you do and trying to make your life better to fix what bugs you. So in 2014, that's when they decided to create the strategic plan to see waste, eliminate waste, and provide value and continuously improve in everything you do. So next. Beautiful, thank you. Okay, so our first step was to do the book club. People have talked about doing that with, we call them a study action team, with everybody in the company. And by everyone, I mean the salaried employees. So we're not talking about union labor. We started our lean huddles, so we meet every single morning. For 15 minutes to 30 minutes. And the whole point of the lean huddles was really to socialize the idea of lean throughout the company. So like I said, amongst the executives, there's a huge disparity in knowledge. So this was just to try to get those 200 to 250 people at least all understanding what lean was about. We started doing lean 101 trainings throughout the company. And we started creating the videos. We have over 500 videos now. Of people making their improvements. And we made Last Planner our scheduling method. So we heard a little bit about that earlier today, but I that's essentially a scheduling method that is based on pull and flow and accountability. So we're actually using that in the field, and that became the company-wide standard. So I wanted to talk a little bit today. That was an overview of what we discussed last year while we were here. So what have we done on some of those items to check and adjust? I have heard a lot of people talk about how you start to, you know, you see this large jump in improvement and progress, and you kind of feel like you plateau out a little bit. And we were feeling that way with our lean huddles. So we started them, and like multiple people said, you know, everyone in the company was like, what is this new thing they have us doing? How long is it going to stick around for? Do we really have to go to this thing every morning? And so after they saw that it was sticking around, they really enjoyed it. They started to come, but about a year in, I would say we were starting to get a little stagnant. And people were like, oh, we're going to this meeting again. People weren't showing up. In the beginning, we were trying to be really, we were trying not to force people into it, right? We were trying to get people to want to be there. We offered multiple times in offices to go to your lean huddle. So, you know, our Pasadena office had like four different huddle times to try to work around people's schedules so they could make time for it in their day. And we just found out that it wasn't working. So what we ended up doing was we focused each week on one of the wastes, on one of the eight wastes. And the idea there was that we wanted people to feel like they had a focus for the week. So previously we had just discussed, you know, in your groups, talk about one of the eight wastes that you improved or the 2-second improvement you made, and we were getting crickets. So we thought, well, what if we gave them, and we call it a waste of the week, and you know, the waste of this week is overproduction. So as you go through your week, think about how you're overproducing and then come back and talk to your group about that. That helped a little bit, but it didn't make huge strides. And then I sat down with the CEO and I said, you know, I think we need to hold people accountable. If there's 4 different huddles they can go to in one day, there's no way to know who's really showing up to our huddles. And we don't want to take attendance. So what if we go to just one huddle a day in the office and we tell them that they have to be at that one huddle? And so that's what we did. We moved to one huddle a day and we did it in a visual location. So instead of doing it in a conference room, we're doing it in the middle of everybody's workstations. So you can't miss it. You can, but you know what's going on. I think a lot of people were not showing up, not because they didn't want to be there, but because, let me just get this last email out, right? And then all of a sudden you look up at your clock and you're halfway through the lean huddle and you're just going to miss it today. So we saw a lot of improvement in doing that. We also have been working a lot on just improving our huddles and our videos that are coming out of the field. So originally it was, let's just make a video, send us whatever you have, and the last year has really been focused on make sure you do your before, make sure you do your after, let's talk about which of the 8 wastes you've eliminated, how does that fit with the 4 criteria. So we've gotten a lot of improvement out of that, and we use our lean huddles to share the videos. So people are, we had one week that was called saw week. We focused on just saw safety and table saw improvement within the company. So we had different videos where a carpentry crew came up with a saw table on one job site and they created a video about it. And then a crew on another job site took that video and improved on it and made their own video. And it was kind of like this, you know, contagious excitement with the crews. So those are the small changes we've made to what we were doing previously. The things that are completely new and what we're doing and finding success in is we're creating functional huddles is what we're calling them. So we're taking our daily huddles and we're still meeting twice a week as a large group at the entire office. In Pasadena, that's about 60 people. In Oakland, that's about 25 to 30 people. And then the job sites, they're still meeting amongst themselves. But now Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays, we've grouped people around processes. So we're actually having them map and create what we're calling current best practices for their processes that they complete. So prior to when we were meeting in our lean huddles every morning and talking about the 2-second improvements we were making, they had more to do with, you know, what did you improve at your desk? How did you improve at home? Kind of those small 2-second changes. And we were a little concerned about letting people making bigger improvements to what they do actually at work, because most of our work goes cross-departmentally. So they could improve their own work, but they would potentially make someone else's work harder down the line without knowing it, right? And so what we were doing with our functional huddles is we're actually getting those people together. So we have different roles all meeting together around one process that they complete together. and trying to come up with the current best practice for how they do their work. And what we're trying to do is right now we have, you know, maybe 20 different ways that people are doing one process within the office and job sites. So if we could get those 20 different, you know, ways of doing something down to 5, then we've made progress, right? Now we have 5 different ways to do one thing instead of 20. And you'll see later how we plan on getting it eventually to 1. So that's kind of what this visual was. You know, all these different ways of doing them. If any of you have heard Paul, he came and talked to us about standards and standardization as our Lean 2.0. And he told this, you know, amazing story about, if you think about the airline industry, and there's some airline, you know, there's some companies out there who have 10 different types of planes, 10 different types of, you know, pieces and parts that they have to purchase for these different planes. They have to train their pilots on all the different planes if they want to switch planes or their crew. But then you have Southwest, who has one type of airplane. Every pilot can fly one airplane. Every mechanic can work on that same airplane. So that was kind of our idea, was to get down from these 20 to at least make some progress and get down to around 5. Additionally, we've taken a big focus on actually the people in the field. So the people in the field are the people who add the value to the owner in the end. It's an interesting industry to be in as a general contractor and trying to be applying these lean principles, because our product as a general contractor is information. We don't have a product. Pankow has a division that does just concrete, so we have a concrete product, but as a general contractor, we're managing the job site. We're providing an estimate. We're providing a schedule. We may be, if we're in a design build contract, providing the design, but essentially we're managing subcontractors who put the product in place, right? So it's a little bit harder for us to make the leap from manufacturing and using the principles of lean into what we do as a company. But we do have some crews on site. And so as a general contractor, we, you know, do a lot of putting up the fence on site, or making sure the site is clean, taking care of the porta potties, all of the stuff that has to be done on a job site but is not done by a specialty sub. And then we also do our own concrete work, which is where we make a lot of our money as a company. So we really started focusing on trade training, and actually, so we spent 15 really focused on getting all of the project management staff up to speed on lean and why it's important and the value that they get out of it. And in 16, we've actually taken that to the field now, and we're training the union labor on lean. So these are guys that are just out of the hall. We, you know, make a phone call. We get guys to, you know, who come out to the site, and they may be there for 3 weeks. They may be there for 6 months, just depending on the size of the job. But we're really trying to focus on training them to understand what lean is about and to see waste and eliminate it. So the training program is essentially, we go out there and we do a training on one of the wastes or two of the wastes, and then they have a couple of weeks to go out and look for waste, and they use this observation report to do that. And then they come back and they tell us what they've learned, what improvements they've made, and we teach them about the next waste. So it's a very powerful tool. And we do it in a program similar to what we do our safety inspections in. So they're out. So our engineers are doing it, the foremen are doing it, and the tradespeople have the opportunity to do it as well. And then additionally, we're doing a recognition program for our field crews. And so if they come up with a lean improvement, they can put it into a suggestion box. The foreman or superintendent on the job site then pulls it out. And if it's an improvement that we actually implement, then they get, you know, recognition for that. At the next huddle, they get, you know, called up and, hey, this was the improvement this person made. This is how much money we're expecting to save. They get a gift card. And so just one way to show the value that we're really seeing out of the improvements that the people on the front line are making for us. In 16, we implemented... We standardized and made a requirement our daily huddles for our foremen. And what we did was, before, so we had the last planner system as our scheduling software, the way that we do our scheduling. But we're making this mandatory that all foremen, so all subcontractor foremen, they may not work directly for Pankow, but we have hired them to do the work on the job site, must come to this 15-minute meeting every day. And they talk about the waste, and they talk about how they're going to improve what they're doing in their workspace, and they talk about schedule, which has really improved the flow on the project. And so we forced them to talk about what were they supposed to do yesterday, did they get it done, what are they doing today, and what's the plan for tomorrow on a daily basis. So we went from, as a company, having 3-week scheduling meetings where our internal staff on the job site would sit for 3 to 4 hours trying to plan the schedule for the next week or two for all the crews. And then on top of that, we would have all this foreman who come in to that meeting, to a meeting for an hour to review it and maybe kind of get some accountability, but really not. It's just kind of like, okay, if that's what you tell me I have to do, I'll say yes, I can't guarantee it. To now we have these meetings with them, we plan 6 weeks in advance, and then we sit down in a meeting, we put all that, the plan for the 6 weeks together, and then we meet with them on a daily basis to check in on their work. So the meeting that we have with them once a week is down to 45 minutes. So we've gone ourselves from having 5 hours of scheduling in 1 week internally to 45 minutes, 45 minutes to an hour and a half if you count the daily check-ins. So it's really been a huge improvement. So what's coming? So where are we going with this? So like I said, we're really trying to get down to the one type of airplane, to one way of doing a process, both in the field and in the office. And we're going to start with what we're calling our P2I events, or Pankow Process Improvement Events. We're going to take the current best practices that our functional huddle groups come up with and create a, and then do like a Kaizen event. We try not to use Japanese words because so many people in construction think that it's manufacturing only. But that's why we're calling them P2I events. And come up with a new company standard. And it was interesting. There's been some discussion about, you know, how do you make it successful? And Paul had said, you know, you have to come back and check on it, and you have to make sure it's being used. And we just started rolling out the functional huddles, and I have a bunch of documentation, you know, templates and how-tos and stuff for the groups as they start to do this. And I went to upload it to where I wanted to send people to find the information, and I found that we have 50 to 60 process maps completed already, that were all done in probably 2008 and 2009. So someone spent a lot of time making process maps, and they were sitting on a drive somewhere that nobody is using. And it just goes to show the fact that the standard, the process has to come from the people who are doing it, and not from above, not from another group who's actually think they're creating the standard and then trying to push it down to everybody else. So that's really what we're trying to do with the functional huddles. Create a current best practice, get it down to 5, get a leader from each of those groups to come to the Pankow Process Improvement Event, and let's create a standard. And then I think one thing huge that we learned this year is that with a company that's as spread out as we are, we're gonna have to retrain our managers and our leaders to manage to that standard. And so I think that's gonna be a huge part of these improvement events, is to create the standard, create the IKEA template so that everyone knows how to do it based on some pictures, and then train our managers to actually manage to that standard so there is the continuous check-in, so that the process maps and the standards don't go into a folder that then nobody looks at for another 10 years. I think that is it. Questions?
So Sarah, the whole thing is very interesting. Why do you think people create these maps and think they're actually adding value and then put them on a file and nobody ever looks at them? What's going on there?
I think that those maps were created in our tool, they were created in our tool-focused time period before we understood that Lean is about a culture and about building the people. And so it was like, oh, well, we should process map everything that we do. And there were definitely some huge improvements. I hear stories about them, and it was, oh, well, we had this one process, and we sat down and we mapped it, and HR touched something 12 times. And we looked at it, and we said, they don't need to do that, and they made some changes. The problem is then the process map didn't go anywhere from that. They made the changes. They may have made the changes internally, but they never made it visual. They never made it something that people were managing to, and they've never kept them current. So I think that
And they didn't get the people on the shop floor to be part of
making it.
So exactly. What's your one takeaway? You've been doing this a long time. You've been involved in all different facets of it. You know, rolling back, what would you do differently if you could just do it all over again from the beginning right now? What is the one thing you would do differently?
I think the one thing I would do differently and the one thing I've learned is that it takes time to get people to come along with you. And like you said, you have to be diligent about following up and trying to do less for a longer period of time and not be concerned about not making progress. And the fact that if you try to take on too much at once, you're not going to get the follow-up, you're not going to get it sustainable. So, you know, for us, we kind of came out of the gate with the tools and let's implement all these tools. And now, you know, we're slowing down and making sure that we have enough time to make something sustainable and add value for the people who are doing it. And that's one of the huge things that you mentioned and that I think we learned as well is that you have to show immediate value to the people. They have to get why they're doing it. We did the functional huddle pilot on a couple of job sites, and it was interesting. One job site took a process to map and implement their changes in their standard that they were already in the middle of, that they did on, it was field payroll time cards, the field time cards for all the crews, right? So they have to fill out what they worked on so we can code all the costs accordingly. And they do it every single week. They have to do this process. And they saw huge value in it. And the entire team was so excited to start the next process map and create their next current best practice. The other team who we piloted it on chose a process that they weren't currently doing. They were setting themselves up for success in the future, but they didn't see the immediate value in it because they couldn't implement it right away. And they were a little less enthusiastic about the next round of process mapping and creating their standards. So the takeaway is we're telling everyone now, choose your first process. You needed instant gratification with your groups as you do this. So choose something, you know, it's what bugs you now, not what you think is gonna bug you in a couple weeks or a couple months. But as a leader of your functional huddle, make sure your group chooses something that they're gonna get instant gratification out of. Right, nothing abstract.
Question here. Since you work with such a big general contracting company, you talked about your value stream and the people within it that's on your payroll. Do you consider sub-trades part of that value stream? If so, can you give me one example of where you would have included them or how you would have helped a sub-trade that wasn't directly employed by you?
Absolutely. They're definitely part of the value stream. They are definitely the ones putting the work in place. And, you know, I think of a construction site as one big commitment that's built on thousands of little commitments that happen every single day between our trades. So what we do involve them in our scheduling in the last planner system. They're key to that success and the training of them. And I think that getting them to understand the benefit in doing that system and how important it is for their commitments and for them to be accountable and how it improves the entire project site and it'll improve their profitability if all of them are accountable to each other is huge. In addition to that, we have one of our strategic goals as a company outside of Lean is to revolutionize the project delivery method for construction from design through closeout. And we're looking now to identify subcontractors that get Lean and who buy into it and are behind it and trying to set up ways to pair up with them and create teams to go after projects together, knowing that we're gonna work together this way.
Another question. Mm-hmm. While you're pairing up with these Lean companies, will price still be the big driver, or will Lean supersede price?
It's definitely Lean will supersede price, because if you can all work together and be efficient, then your price will be cheaper in the end.
I wish all general contractors were like you.
Thank you.
You don't have one anymore? You good? Oh, that was his question too. So here's Dave Hagan.
Hey there.
Good.
Great presentation, thank you. So how do you guys handle onboarding of employees. Because for us, it's a challenge, right? I mean, I wouldn't say that we're a revolving door, but we're always adding new relationships to the mix. And we have found that you can't just drop people into the culture. I mean, that, if the culture is really strong, you can get part of the way there. Just curious, how's you guys manage that?
It's definitely something we're still working on. We have an engaged leadership group who's studying that very thing right now. Because it is, as an industry, it's a difficult thing that we're dealing with, both salaried and then union payroll. So with the salaried folks, we do they all get handed Paul's book. And I think the answer is going to have to be our leadership, and that we have to get all of our leaders bought in and fostering the correct culture in order for it to kind of just be innate, you know, that so that when they come, so that as a hire out of college comes to Pankow, they don't know anything different. I think that's where we're going to get our biggest, you know, bang for our buck, is to get everybody it bought 100% into the culture, not the artificial buy-in, but the real buy-in.
Yeah,
you know, it's kind of like when we were touring yesterday, and you can just see, it was so inspiring to see every single employee understand and have a passion for it. And so if you can get to that point where a new hire comes in and they just experience that, would be huge.
I was just going to say that I would agree with you that people just out of school, you don't have to break the old paradigm, right? They think, why wouldn't you do it this way? It's the people who have been entrenched in the business for 30 or 40 years who have a hard time embracing it.
Absolutely. I actually took a photo of the slide that said, you know, it's what, you know, you, I can't, the bad apple, right? And it's whatever you're willing to withstand. And we definitely have a few of those people. The people that have, you know, have been at Pankow for 35 years or 30 years and are our superintendents who have always done it one way. And they're our biggest obstacle. They definitely are. I do have to say, though, that we've had a couple of people, unfortunately, good people who have left Pankow and gone to work for other general contractors. And I've run into them and they say, you know, at the time, I used to think, God, why do we have to do these lean huddles again? And now I don't have it. And I see waste in everything that happens at other companies. And it drives me crazy. It drives me absolutely crazy. So it's nice to see someone who was fresh out of college, came to work for Pankow, didn't know anything else, and has now moved on and is starting to see the benefits of what we were doing. So
we got time for one more question. Or not.
Everyone's really hungry.
All right, Paul, we'll close it out before lunch.
Sarah, is David the president? Is that, do I remember correctly? What's his name?
Dave.
Yeah, Dave.
Yeah.
How engaged is he in this whole thing?
Dave is very engaged. I would say, so Kim Lum is our CEO.
That's right. Yeah.
He is 110% bought in. And
Kim, right.
Yeah, he's definitely, he's doing a book club with us now on value stream mapping. We're in the process of trying to map our value stream. I talk to him, I mean, weekly. So he is 110% bought in. Dave is also very bought in. I would say he's, his tendency, just personality-wise, is a little command and control, which is obviously, so lean is a little against his natural grain, I guess. But he's definitely come around. He attends all of our lean huddles. He participates in all of the, he goes out to the job sites and does the trainings. He does observations. I think that for him, it's a little bit, more difficult to get there than Kim, but both of them are behind us 100% and pushing the company this way, which has been huge. Do you have a follow-up?
Yeah, well, I do. I'm just trying to formulate it in my head. I'm just thinking a little
bit. So, I guess I'm confused. I'm being honest.
Sure.
I'm confused because I know Kim. I've met Kim. And he seems to be very much on fire. I can't remember specifically meeting Dave. But I'm confused that if you have two leaders at the top that are 100% bought in, how you could have a foreman that is not getting it. I mean, I don't understand how, you know, I'm a leader, so I'm maybe a little bit different. But I don't know how you could have someone that isn't getting it. you got to get it. This is what you guys are. This is important to the company, or is it just, it's important, but it's just one of the things that's important. Do you know what I'm trying to say?
I understand what you're saying. It's I think that, you know, Kim, they say if you can't change the people, change the people. And I would say that's true for 90% of the people that are at the company. And even with when we were setting up the functional huddles and we were worried about certain people being accountable and actually participating and creating their current best practice, and Kim's answer was, well, if they're not going to do it, they'll find their way out the door eventually, right? So he is no for most people, he's 100% fine with that way. I think there's a couple of superintendents who have dedicated their life to the company, and he has a little bit harder of a time showing them the door when they're on the verge of retiring and been with the company for 35 years. And that's just a little, I want to say it's respect. It's kind of that family, you know, part of the business that everyone, that we have as our culture, that you're not going to show someone the door after 35 years. But I took, you know, I was thinking about this last night after hearing everyone speak and multiple times, just fire the people and you get your bad apples. And I was thinking to myself, so we're paying the superintendent to sit out at a job site and he's toxic to the team there, right? So as a company, if we want to keep him on, then let's keep him on, but bring him in the office to do something where he has less of a toxic influence on the people that we can actually change right now, the people who are young enough in their career that they're willing to try it out. So I think that's going to be my next thing that I bring up with them when I get back is, you know, as a company, if we want to keep them around, let's keep them around where they're not influencing people, you know, if they have a couple years left, as much as they are on a job site. So.
Thanks a lot.